IVM.
Once upon a time, a long, long time ago, there was a mountain, and there were two little kingdoms that lived in it. They were both very similar in terms of religion and in terms of their rulers. The mountain separated two giant countries, and if anything should happen between them, then these two little kingdoms would bear the brunt of it. You would think that the two little kingdoms would have similar stories, similar destinies. But that's where you're wrong. One kingdom continued to exist, and the other was annexed a long time ago by one of the larger countries. This is a tale of self-image, of diplomacy and foreign policy. Welcome to States of Anarchy. I'm your host, Hamsini Hariharan, and every week on the show, I break down issues in global affairs and foreign policy. The story that I told you is one that you're possibly familiar with already. In the 1940s, to all external observers, Bhutan and Sikkim were similar in very many aspects. They were both small, they were both Buddhist, and they were both monarchies on the border between India and China. The Kingdom of Bhutan continues to be the largest recipient of Indian foreign aid today. Sikkim, on the other hand, was annexed in 1975 and became the 22nd state of the Indian Republic. Why did the paths of these two countries have such drastic divergences? Why didn't India annex Bhutan? How does Indian self-image play into all of this? My guest for today is someone who's worked extensively on this topic. Deep Pal finished his PhD at the University of Washington's Henry M. Jackson School of International Studies. He looked at the dynamics of the Sino-Indian relationship since the mid-20th century, and he's also a non-resident fellow at the National Bureau of Asian Research. But before we get into the conversation with Deep, let's hear from IVM Podcasts.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you are not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. After crossing 10,000 on Instagram a couple of weeks ago, this week we crossed 5,000 followers on Twitter. If you aren't following us on Twitter, please do. Make sure that you see all the cool stuff that we put out there. We do some cool stuff on social media, just generally. You should check it out. This week we are launching a new show called Heal and Hearty. It's hosted by Rachna Chachi, nutritional therapist and certified cancer coach. She helps you understand the right nutrition, exercise and lifestyle that keep diseases away. Show premieres on Tuesday, 15th October. In case you missed it, do check out our daily policy podcast called All Things Policy. It's hosted by the researchers at the Takshashila Institute who break down complex economic and geopolitical ideas through the lens of current affairs. New episodes are out every single day. It's a fun show. Do check it out. On Cyrus Says, Cyrus is joined by Devika Mandrekar. She talks about being obsessed with the TV show Friends, the joys of being a chef, and growing out of the shadow of her father, Sanjay Mandrekar. The Simplified Gang received a lot of questions from you guys, forcing Chuck, Naren, and Shriket to record a second part of their special 150th episode. Make sure you tune in. On The Habit Coach, Ashton talks about the Hawaiian practice of reconciliation, forgiveness, and how phrases can impact your life. On Gay BCD, Sunetra and Farad reminisce about school and discuss the effects of being bullied because of one's queer identity. On the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast, Ashwin, DJ and Varun deep dive into the first test between India and South Africa. On the Pragati Podcast, Anne Devereux joins Pawan to share how NASA and JPL plan and manage interplanetary missions. On Boundless, Natasha reads poems on the themes of stepping outside of your comfort zone. On Paisa Vaisa, Anupam is joined by Saman Sikka, Chief Dream Officer at Squirrel. They have an interesting conversation about how his team came up with the name. And with that, let's get on with your show.
Hi, Deep. Welcome to States of Anarchy. I'm very glad to have you join me.
Thank you. Very happy to be here.
All right. So when you think about foreign policy, there are a lot of factors that feed into it. Mm-hmm. I know that one factor that you've researched a lot on is self-image and how that plays into a country's foreign policy. So can you tell me a little bit about how self-image works with India?
Right. So as you mentioned, right, there are various kinds of issues and components, internal, external, right? When we read IR, we read about all these. So external factors determine decision making, mm-hmm. and this and state behavior and all of that. But there is this one aspect of it which pertains to how does a state look at itself, and how does that reflect in its decision making, right? When you think of it, it seems pretty intuitional, right?
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, we believe we are something, a state believes they're something, and then on the basis of that, you know, it should reflect in some way on decision making, right?
Like sort of the values that a state holds?
Values that a state holds, right? But I mean, the values represent themselves or reflect themselves in various ways, mm-hmm. right? So yeah. one of those ways is self-image. So if you look at IR and if you look at this guy called Robert Jervis, right? Mm-hmm. He talks about images and perceptions, mm-hmm. right? Basically, essentially what he's saying is that a state has certain images of itself, mm-hmm. Which it projects constantly mm-hmm. and expects other states to form impressions about them on the basis of those images that they project, right? So images and perceptions are constantly playing. And he also says that, okay, if a state projects certain images and sees that other states are not looking at them the way they would want to be looked at, they change their behavior to ensure that the images that they're projecting fit them, right? Okay. So they're constantly, so there are certain images that a state would project and it is even ready to change behavior to ensure those images are upheld.
All right. How does this play out in terms of India, for example?
Right. For India, for example, there when you look at the region, right? Mm-hmm. So when we look at the contemporary history of India, right, 47 onwards, if that is a period, last 70 years, if that's that's a good period of time to look at, right? So if you look at that period of time, there are a number of these behaviors, acceptances of historic events or renunciations, for example, that would, if you string them together, you see that there are certain kind of things that are acceptable, certain kind of things that are not acceptable, right? And if you try to turn that around to understand, okay, what does this say about India's self-image, right? You find a number of these components, a number of these factors, right? So one of them I would suggest is this idea of a civilizational connection, right?
All right.
So in the region, in the in the immediate neighborhood, India has this aspect of self-image, for example, if you call it, which suggests that India is civilizationally connected to all its neighbors, right? Now, to some extent, this connection is geographic, right? So if you look at not just during the Raj, but even if we go beyond, far beyond that, so from Afghanistan onwards to Bangladesh, parts of Myanmar, there are parts of those geographies have been part of what we today consider India under the British before that, right? So there's always been that to an extent.
There's this idea that, you know, even before India became a modern nation state, that there was this political, geographical consciousness of being Indian. And there you can, of course, debate that from various angles and poke holes with it. But it is sort of one school of thought, right, that says that there's an Akhand Bharat that existed all the way in the Middle Ages that lent a civilizational unity to the subcontinent.
Right. So what I'm not sure of is if you would say that this was the idea of being Indian as we consider today the idea of being Indian. But I think for a long time there has been idea of this being a part of something bigger, right? So that has existed. And most definitely, if we look at the last 70 years, this has existed, right?
Yeah.
Possibly this is a social, cultural, communal, people-to-people kind of a connection, right? That has always been there, right? So there's that idea of being civilizationally connected to all of these. And remember, this is not just geographic, right? So in some cases, like, for example, with Tibet or with Sikkim or with Bhutan, right? There's the connection of Buddhism. Right. So that's also something that we hear a lot about now. But so connections are of knowledge or of faith as well. Right. So there are these are various ways in which you can be connected to another part of the world civilization. Right.
Yeah. So you have all these overlapping networks, not just of trade or faith, but also just relationships, I guess, of pilgrimages, of various factors that are at play that sort of build up what a civilization is.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So all of these various ways in which the civilizational aspect of the connections, that's one. Another very important aspect of self-image that I consider is that of this anxiety over territory, right? Now, of course, one way of looking at it is that all nation states, all modern nation states are anxious about their territory. They are, right? They almost everyone puts soldiers in their borders, right? I mean, if you look at the U.S. and the southern border of the U.S. right now, right? So there are soldiers in the border and you won't let others cross over and all of that. Sure. So in India's case, also the one large part of this territorial anxiety has to do with 1947 partition and everything else, right?
But aren't new states generally anxious about their territories?
They usually are. So post-colonial states usually are.
Yeah.
In India's case, it's even more pronounced because of the history of partition.
Yes,
right?
Of course.
So there is obviously this idea that, okay, this is what India was supposed to be. And then you suddenly tear away two parts in the east and the west, which eventually become two different countries years later. But what that does is from 47 or from 1950s, if you see, there is this idea that something went missing, right? Mm. Something that was supposed to be a part of independent India went missing, right? Which reflects in this idea that whatever now India claims as its own, as its territory, is non-negotiable.
Okay.
Right. So, yeah. So there is that very stringent idea that, which is why when we look at Indian maps, right, part of Aksai Chin, part of Pakistan occupied Kashmir, we see them very assiduously guarded in our maps, right?
Even though, and it's a punishable sort of offense to represent them as anything but.
Exactly, right? I mean, that very strong belief that, no, this is exactly how the Indian map must be represented at all times. So there is that, which also connects with the idea that, you know, there are these scholars, Steve Hoppen, for example, someone who writes about how one of the ideas of Indian nationalism also involved looking at boundaries as something that has been transferred to India through time. Right. So when we talk about the Himalayan boundaries, right, as the Himalayas as the northern boundary of India, right, it's indisputable, right? So that watershed and everything else, right, irrespective of what political realities are, no, that is what our the boundaries are, right? So there is that idea. So territorial anxiety is another aspect. And a third aspect, which to an extent came to us as a legacy of the Raj, but it's also something that independent India from very early on has been following on, is the idea of development as a component of foreign policy, right? Okay. So the idea that for India to develop, the region has to be developed, right? And India as a bigger player has to help develop all of the various other actors, smaller actors. They obviously are smaller actors, right? India.
Yeah, of course.
The largest actor in the region. So it has to help all of these smaller actors to the extent that it can, right? So even today, when we look at Nepal, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, you know, Bhutan, any of the countries, right? Even Afghanistan, right? Most of India's aid goes into its neighborhood, right? So these are basically three components that I look at, which form very strong aspects of India's self-image, right? So India basically wants to say, on the basis of this, this is who we are, right? So,
Just about your last point about development as a way of looking at India's self-image, do you think this came from the idea that, A, it, of course, having a successful neighborhood will mean that these states become stronger in their own right and therefore the region would develop? That's one way to look at it. The second is something that I wonder, is it also something that comes from sort of conversations about socialism that the government was having at that point in time, or was that completely different?
I think there is the aspect of socialism to an extent, but I would say there is a more instrumental reason, which is that, you know, as you help these countries develop, these states develop, right? And remember, this entire region is of post-colonial states, right?
Yeah.
Everyone, right?
Yeah.
So all of them are starting from a pretty low base. Mm. India has the advantage of having been the center, the jewel in the crown, right, of the British Raj and everything else. And it's much larger. So obviously more resources of every kind and more people. So what it also does is, if you're helping these states, very instrumentally, what it ensures as are these states are to an extent beholden to India, right? Which you see reflecting in the changes that are happening, let's say in the last 10, 15, 20 years, right? As we talk about China, as you know, as they have entered into what India has always considered its own sphere of influence, and they are offering the kind of services that these states were expecting from India, and they're saying, hey, we're going to do it faster and everything else. India has this problem with that idea, right? Come on, these are guys who have always depended on us to help them out with these things. And now suddenly there's another player, right? And that's a problem.
Yeah, and you could see it very clearly reflected like in the Maldives or in Sri Lanka when the recent elections happened and they said, no, India is interfering with our democratic processes. And then you had China saying the Maldivian government should function as it sees fit. And then Indians becoming angry over the idea and saying, this is our neighborhood. You know, this has always sort of been our playground, and it's unfair for other players to come into it. But just going back to the idea of India's self-image, how did India's self-image affect its foreign policy in South Asia?
So I would say it had a very central role, right? Because, you know, we all know about Nehru and everyone is talking about this new India and everything else, right? Yeah. And so what does this new India mean, right? So obviously, this includes very strongly rebuffing influence from both the
the United States,
the USSR, UK, right? Mm. To be not seen getting close to any of the so-called empires, right? Mm. So which is one of the reasons, as we know, that the early Indian government was very careful not to side even with the United States, right? In the 50s, when the US was looking for an ally in South Asia and everything, which eventually made them seek out Pakistan, which is a whole different story. But so that's one part of it, right? So we are seeing these leaders talking about there being a new India. Okay, so who is this new India going to be? So this new India is going to be someone who is going to help others around it, right? Which extends, it's possible to argue that this extends into the non-aligned movement, right? So we are all of these post-colonial nations who will stick together and advance into a new century, right? At some point in the early 50s, this even involved China, right? Where Nehru and others again seem to believe that India and China are going to be the two engines which are going to bring Asia into the new century and things like that. So that's one way of looking at it. The self-image aspect of it is, I would argue, very central to forming a whole new identity for independent India, right? Which is, so another very interesting example is, in 1950, right? When the Korean War breaks out, right? India has absolutely no locus standi, right? To wade into the middle of that extremely complex...
But they were the head of the Neutral Nations Repatriation Commission.
Right. So one of the reasons why... What that reflects to my mind is this idea that... So you don't have economic power, right? You don't have military power. You don't have political clout, okay? What do you have? You have what Nehru very famously argued multiple times was you have moral power. Right. Mm. So you basically argue that, okay, we are going to show how you conduct yourselves as a fair member of the international community. Mm. Right. So this was one way of inserting India into the world stage, getting noticed. Mm. Right. It was also another way of guiding or suggesting the direction in which independent India should be conducting its foreign policy. These are some of the ways in which I think we could look at this.
Yeah. It's also interesting when you're talking about India's self-image. One of the sort of important aspects of nationalism, right, is identifying your nation as distinct from an other nation. So I am Pakistani by virtue of not being Indian. Mm-hmm. I am Sri Lankan because I am not Bangladeshi. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, India likes to stress on its civilizational ties with all of these countries. Mm-hmm. How do you think there's an interplay between both those variables?
Right. So before I get into that, one of the things is, I think I'm Pakistani because I'm not Indian is it's a very sui generis way case,
yes,
right? Because
yeah.
One of the ways in which Pakistan or the elites or decision makers in Pakistan, right, have existed is by saying, oh, we are un-India. We are what India is not, right?
Yes,
But having said that, so as far as India is concerned, I think what has helped India to always claim the civilizational connection is to be able to see that, we are kind of the origin, right? So this is where Buddhism, for example, emanated from us, right? This is where, so Atish Dipankar crossed over, and took his knowledge of Buddhism with him, right? So that's something we have given, okay? We have been the source, so to speak, okay, of these various ways in which others have been enriched, right? And that also connects to development, right? That's not something that we did 2,500 years ago during Buddha's time. Even now, we are helping, let's say, Bhutan get its hydropower projects in place, Chukha and others. This is also the time when we are helping, other states form their bridges and parliament houses and ports and whatnot, right?
Yeah,
So that is basically the connection, okay? We are in a position to help you, right? That constantly allows India to get into those positions, into the central position in amongst all of these states.
Yeah, that's interesting because you have these states often label India as a big brother and criticize it for its dominance in the region. But I think sort of looking at it in terms of self-image also lets you see where India is coming from in terms of its own policy. But something that I know that you've worked a lot on is looking at how India's policies differed towards Bhutan and Sikkim. Mm-hmm. And I thought these were two really interesting case studies. So maybe I thought we could speak a little bit about that. Shall we we start with Bhutan?
Sure. Before we do that, on the issue of Big Brother, if we can just go back for one quick second, leaving aside the obvious connotations of Big Brother in today's
milieu,
even leaving that on aside, you know, so the other way, and this is something that I realized when I was speaking to people from these various other states in South Asia, when I was speaking with them, I realized that one part of India's approach with all of these states, okay, where, look, it is the obvious big player, in terms of human resources, in terms of technological advancement, in terms of capital, in every way you can imagine, right? What that has also ensured is bring about a certain kind of hubris in the behavior that maybe technocrats, maybe bureaucrats, maybe various people, okay, that have dealt with all of these players. Now, that is not something that is that most of these other states like, okay? Just because you're helping us does not allow you to talk down to us, right? That's that's a lesson. If you, I mean, I have looked at these archival materials. That's something that has existed from the 1950s, right? I mean, there are letters where Jawaharlal Nehru has found these complaints reaching him from the king of Bhutan, okay, and he passes that on to others in the foreign ministry and says that, you know, this is something that we need to remember, or this kind of behavior is something that we need to refrain from. We are not, because this is how an imperial power, colonial power, behaves. Now, it is completely possible that the behavior emanated from that, right? Because the early technocrats, bureaucrats were all people who had worked with the British. And culturally, at least, that some of that did pass on through the years.
Sure.
Right. It's completely possible that that is where it started. But that's also something that's very important to remember.
Yeah, I agree. I think when I was doing research in Southeast Asia, and India often stresses on its ties through Southeast Asia, whether it's the spread of Buddhism or the idea that some Tamil kings went up to Indonesia. This is not something that Southeast Asians are a big fan of. They've often complained of sort of high-handedness on the part of Indian diplomats when they're stressing on cultural values. Because how some of these states look at it is their own local culture adopted things that traders and other people brought in. And it's a process of globalization, but this is their own unique culture. And by sort of high-handedly stressing that India is sort of the birthplace of all of these things, takes away from their own merits and values in that sense.
Oh, absolutely. So when they stand there, they look at their role in this, right? I mean, so when India talks about, oh, we gave this, right? Anyone is within their rights to say, maybe you gave it, but it was on us whether we wanted it or not, whether they took it or not, right? Just as in the way that you say that, you know, there is this question of, or India is accused of high-handedness. I remember reading about this document from late 1950s, okay, this gentleman who worked with the Indian government, I'm not going to name him, who talked about how, now Nehru had this habit of invoking India and China and the future of Asia, okay, Indian China together and the future of Asia in many of his speeches, many of his conversations, right? And this gentleman who had met some of the people in the Chinese leadership, including Chou Enlai and others, he writes in a diary that, you know, my sense is that they don't quite like it. They think that he is overstepping in his behavior, or in his in the way he implies that India is I mean, who is India to basically say that India and China are going to do this, right? China is free to make up its own mind what it wants to do, right? What is this tying China together with India anywhere he goes, right? So he kind of suggests that maybe this is an example of Indian high-handedness, which China doesn't like as much, right? As we see happening in the next, this is from the second half of 1950s. So as we see, as the events unfold over the next 5-6 years, we see that this gentleman wasn't very wrong about Chinese behavior and Chinese feelings of high-handedness from India about this, right?
True. And also, when you think about the 1962 war between India and China, I think when people say India's moral power took a hit, particularly mm-hmm. with respect to the non-aligned movement and all of that, I can see where it comes from, because India is so deeply tied a mm-hmm. lot of its reputational power with mm-hmm. how its diplomats were behaving, as well as its own self-image, as you put it. And all of these factors, I don't know if it's fair to say that it didn't stand the test when it came to the 1962 war, or how it fared with that.
So I think the immediate causes of the 1962 war were some other causes, right? Yeah. As we know, one was the forward policy, and I mean, the assumption, Nehru and others, they did not think that that was really going to push China into war.
Yeah. You know,
and plus, there was the aspect of the Dalai Lama crossing over in 1959, right? Which has extremely, which had angered Mao Zedong and others, and there was that. But I also think one of the... This is also recorded in history about how this shocked Nehru to an extent, where he wasn't the same person he was before October 1962, after November 1962, right?
Yes.
And eventually he passes on in 1964. But the fact that what I think that also points at is that at no point possibly did Nehru think that India's behavior could be construed to be such which would bring a war upon itself, you know. Now, remember, this is, so the second war with Pakistan hasn't taken place yet, right?
Yeah.
That's 1965. That happens in a few years. Though enmity with Pakistan or antagonism towards and from Pakistan is something that's more or less established at that point in time.
It's a part of the status quo, right?
It's right. Now, as far as China is concerned, what... I think one of the ways to look at this would also be that no one really thought that, I mean the assumption was that India's stand issues could not be, there was no one who didn't believe it. You know, the assumption was that there was no one who didn't believe what India said about why it did various things. The Dalai Lama, for example, right? By this time in China, we see the assumption or the understanding that, oh, the reason why India's, you know, allowed the Dalai Lama to stay in and his people to stay in is to be able to use him as leverage, right? But if you look at documents from that time, from the Indian side, there is absolutely no sign of that, right? There is, again, that conversation about civilizational connection.
Yeah.
You know, if an individual Tibetan identity is completely going to be wiped off and replaced by a Chinese, a Han Chinese identity, then how do we preserve the Tibetan identity? Maybe in the form of the Dalai Lama staying in India. That's the conversation that has happened in 59. That's the idea that Nehru and others in their conversations have tried to give, right? And the assumption is that the world will understand it. The world will believe it, right? So in 62, when the war happens, the greatest, I think, surprise or shock about that is that how did no one believe what we said? That was something completely new.
Yeah, I guess it makes sense that the Indians didn't think that their narrative would sort of be questioned, because perhaps A, it hadn't been challenged very much on the world stage before, and B, they didn't think that it would turn against them, which in a lot of cases it did across the world, particularly because of things like the forward policy and how that played out. So, yeah, in that sense, I can understand how those factors came into play. Moving on to how India's self-image plays out in its neighborhood. Let's start with Bhutan. Bhutan's a fairly small kingdom. Tell me a little bit about the history of India-Bhutan ties, particularly around this time, and how they evolved.
Right. So if you're looking at Sikkim and Bhutan, right, I mean, these are two great cases to look at when it comes to Indian foreign policy. And, well, Sikkim is now a state, but that's something that happened in 1975. Before that, it had its own king, its own government and everything else, right? So these are two very interesting cases to look at, especially because they're two, you know how similar. So in research, we talk about similar cases, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So when you look at these two states, they're two tiny Buddhist monarchies, both Himalayan, both sandwiched between India and Tibet / China, however you want to put that, right? So, and when we look at India's policies towards them, what is so fantastic is that, in both cases, India inherits relationships from the British, right? The British had treaty relationships, which we will get into in a bit, but had treaty relationships with them. After 1947, India has its own treaties with these two entities. And what we see happening after that is fascinating. because we see that India's relationship with Bhutan develops in a completely different clip than with Sikkim. In early 1970s, now Bhutan and Sikkim both try to have a more autonomy, right? And in 1970s, early 1970s, we see that India helps Bhutan become a member of the United Nations, sponsors its membership and everything else. And there are these conversations that are going on at that point between the various bureaucrats and everyone else, you know, because they're talking, hey, you know, there is this assumption across the world that Bhutan is not completely sovereign because of its relationship with India, right? And how do we tackle that? And Indian diplomats are talking about, the MEA actually sends a circular across the to all of its embassies saying, okay, this is how you tackle this question, right? And as we see, the world is convinced by that. And in 1971, Bhutan becomes the becomes a member of the United Nations, right? As far as Sikkim is concerned, when Sikkim talks about more autonomy, we see India very reluctant on that front, leading to the point where the Sikkimese king, who was called the Chogyal, the Sikkimese king's power and authority being reduced okay, in the early 1970s, leading eventually in 1974 for Sikkim to become an associated state of India. And in 1975, the Chogyal is deposed and Sikkim becomes the 22nd state of India, which is completely opposite of what we have seen in Bhutan happen, It's in the last 3-4 years, right? And basically, what I suggest is much of this is in response to how these two states behaved, you know, in response to India's self-image and concerns, right? How these two behaved when it came to India's approach of civilizational connections, how they behaved when it came to India's territorial anxiety, because both of them, remember, they bordered China, right? And how they behaved when it came to Indian projects of development and aid, right? So that's basically part of my project, right? Now, as far as Bhutan is concerned, Bhutan is this kingdom which was brought together in the early 20th century by a king who brought about the beginning of the Wangchuk dynasty, right? So the current king is the fifth in line. So this gentleman was the, Ugyen Wangchuk was the first king of the Wangchuk dynasty. He started in, I think, early 20th century. And a British treaty with them was signed soon after, right? Which formed a foundation of Bhutan's relationship with British India, right? So this treaty, which was signed, I think, around 1910, essentially said that, it was called the Treaty of Punakha, which basically said that British India is going to advise Bhutan on external relations, right? Okay. As far as internal matters were concerned, there will be no involvement from anyone. Sure. The Bhutanese were free to go about it themselves.
And is this different from what British India said to a lot of the princely states?
This, to an extent, is different because at this point, the British were more or less okay with letting Bhutan go about their business. I mean, in fact, as an example, if you look at Sikkim, for example, which was not a princely state per se, but if you look at the treaty that governed British India's relationship with Sikkim, which was signed in the early 1800s, right, Treaty of Tetalia, in that we see that they have extracted the right to trade up to the Tibet border, right? Okay. In exchange of helping Sikkim get back all the land that Nepal had annexed through the years, right? Okay. So the Gorkha Kingdom of Nepal, they were, you know, through wars, taking away land that Sikkim believed to be its own. And when the British defeated Nepal in the First Anglo-Nepalese War, that land, they helped Sikkim get back. And they said that in exchange, okay, we are going to need the right to trade up to Tibetan border, right? What that also meant was being able to place British soldiers near the border, right? So there's that. So yes, there was a difference between how British India conducted its behavior and its relationship with Bhutan than with others around it. Yes.
All right. So what essentially is happening is that, so you said in 1910, Britain signed a treaty with Bhutan.
That's right.
Right. And how did this legacy sort of carry over to 1940s when India got independence?
So after India got independence, there were two separate treaties that were signed, one in 1950 and one in 1949. So the treaty with Sikkim is in 1950 and the treaty with Bhutan is in 1949. And then what we see happen is in the treaty in 1950, we see in India being responsible for communications, okay, defense, and external affairs of Sikkim.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. That's a large mandate.
That's a pretty large mandate, right? And the treaty that is signed with Bhutan in 1949, in that there is this very famous Article 2, which says that, you know, India will advise Bhutan on matters of external relations, right? That's Article 2. Now, as we see later, at various points in time, Indian diplomats are conversing with Bhutanese diplomats, you know, about the nuances of this, okay? Mm. About nuances of Article 2. And Indian diplomats obviously saying that, you know, it means that we are going to advise you. Mm. And the Bhutanese diplomats saying, yes, it says that you're going to advise us, but it doesn't mean that we are bound to go by that advice, right? So all of that happens. And eventually, in 2008, we see when the Indo-Bhutanese Treaty is renewed, we see that Article 2 is dropped. That no longer exists there, right? So this is basically where we see the relationship between the two entities begins to diverge, right? Mm. I mean, so there is this Bhutanese account which says that in 1949, when Nehru and others, they were speaking with the Bhutanese team, with the Bhutanese delegation about the treaty, Nehru kind of said, you know, why don't you allow us to take care of your communications and external relations and, you know, defense, basically
the like same thing as Sikkim, yeah.
The same thing as Sikkim, right? And they say, no, you know, thank you very much. We don't really want to do that, right? But at the same time, it's also another thing to remember here is that, see, these are times when things are in a state of flux, okay? Mm-hmm. There is so much else happening, right? I mean, when we talk about Sikkim, Bhutan, that is the nature of research, right? We make it sound like there was nothing else that was happening anywhere else, which is obviously not true.
Yeah, but if the year is sort of 1949, 1950, there's a lot happening in Kashmir. There are lots happening within, like, the Constituent Assembly debate.
Oh, absolutely.
There's so much happening across the country.
Absolutely. In fact, I mean, so in 1947, January 1947, right, Nehru brings about a special resolution in the Constituent Assembly, which suggests, which allows extra powers to the committee that is negotiating with princely states to deal with Sikkim and Bhutan, right? Which is basically to give the idea that these states are not the regular princely states that, that were being dealt with, right? So that happens. Now, later in 1947, the later Chogyal of Sikkim, at that point, the Maharaj Kumar, he comes to Delhi and he meets the Secretary of State's VP Menon. And he's, you know, he says that, okay, you know, Sikkim is a independent state and it must be treated as such and everything else. And VP Menon listens to him, doesn't commit anything. And the Maharaj Kumar goes back, right? So both sides are having these conversations throughout. But they are also having it at a time when in 47, in 48, in 49, in 50, there is so much else that is going on.
Yeah.
Right? So the basic idea at that point is to just have some kind of a status quo in the relationship and not rock the boat so much, right? Which we see happening with various other steps that the then Indian government begins to take, The idea is to we will figure out how to modify the relationship later.
Mm.
But for now, let's make sure that things just don't go out of hand.
Yeah.
Right. So that's basically where the relationships essentially start after 1947, 1948, 49.
All right. So this happens right after the Indian independence in 1949 and 50. Right. So what happens through the next two decades?
Right. So what we see happening after that is now, so the Maharaj Kumar of Sikkim, right, who he becomes the king in mid-1960s, a little, I think 1963.
All right.
Right. And even before that and even after that, one of the major issues that he concerns himself with is the idea of an independent Sikkimese identity.
Hmm.
Right. Now, independent Sikkimese identity is a very curious animal because when you look at the population of Sikkim, 75% of Sikkimese population is Nepalese.
Right.
Okay. The other 25% is Lepcha and Bhutia.
Hmm.
Now, this 25% are the elites, right? So, essentially, 25 people with 25% majority in the population are basically ruling over people with 75%, who form 75% of the population. Now, we have seen that happen in various other places, right?
Yeah.
It's usually a recipe for disaster. Things don't end well when that happens.
Not necessarily.
Yeah. Now, the Chogyal, who is Lepcha Bhutia, is very keen on asserting this independent Sikkimese identity, right? And he talks about it at various forums. Now, this essentially keeps bumping against India's ideas of having a connection or of various other things, right? So, for example, in 1967, right, there is a skirmish that happens between Indian forces and the PLA in Nathula, right? That happens in October, November. And soon after that, we see the Chogyal and we see his sister kind of saying that, you know, it's difficult to figure out who was responsible for this. It could have been India that was responsible, or it could have been China. Now, India obviously does not take kindly to that, right? A little later, we also see the Chogyal sister talking about, giving a newspaper interview about independent Sikkimese identity, right? So, when you look at the timing, it seems to suggest that these are basically attempts at trying to separate Sikkim from the sphere of influence and assert that, you know, we are players unto ourselves and we have no connections or no relationships with others here. Now, that obviously is not looked at very kindly, right? At the same time, in Bhutan, before we move forward in the years, now, with both Sikkim and Bhutan, we have seen that, you know, Nehru had this affinity for that part of the geography, right? He keeps on traveling there and everything else. He, in fact, was planning to go to Tibet, which did not work out because the relationship with China is already, right? It's on the fritz by that time, late 1950s. So instead, he goes to Bhutan.
Okay.
And he goes to Bhutan in 1958 with Indira Gandhi, right? And they actually, on their way to Bhutan, they had to, so from Sikkim, they had to go into Tibet and then get into Bhutan, right? They were, yeah, the
route. That was the route.
That was the route. In fact, Bhutan did not have a very good connectivity till early 1960s, which is when they had their first five-year plan, which was bankrolled by India. And the second five-year plan was also almost entirely bankrolled by India, but that obviously has changed now. But essentially, you know, when we the issue of development, for example, right? So that's those are ways in which things have been there. But anyway, so Nehru goes to Bhutan in 1958, and he and the then king, Jigme Dorji Wangchuk, they immediately hit it off, right? They have this very interesting rapport, and it seems it's a very interesting relationship where both of them seem to have a sense of respect about the other.
Okay.
Right. And that kind of carried forward the relationship for the next many years, because this gentleman, the king of Bhutan, Jigme Dorji Wangchuk, was a king till 1972. Right, he was king for a really long time, and he actually maintained the relationship with India throughout this period, right? I mean, on one hand, you know, when you see Sikkim really trying to question India's role, right, in the region, or in claiming that we are connected to each other and all of that, this gentleman, on the other hand, we see talking, welcoming Nehru with open hands, talking about Bhutan and India being, you know, partners, in fact, even at some point going on to say that, you know, India is the big brother and things like that. So that really cemented the relationship to a great extent.
And I know that a lot of Bhutanese cadets come to India to the NDA for training. But does this go back to that point in time, or does this come later?
Right. So in the 1960s, around about the time when development funds begin to go, is also when this organization called the IMTRAT, okay, which is basically the Indian Army's team that trains Bhutanese army, right?
Okay.
So that begins to be settled there.
Okay.
Also the Border Road Organization, right? The Border Road Organization is also set up, and that helps build infrastructure in Bhutan. So Indian Army trainers to train Bhutanese Army officers, and the Border Roads Organization. So those two are permanent stations that continue to be in Bhutan from the 1960s.
All right. Okay. On that note, let's just take a short break.
Yep.
Did you know that Parsis in Mumbai, instead of being left at the Tower of Silence after they die, are now cremated? And why? Because a cow fell sick in the early 1990s. Did you know that the smog in Delhi is caused by something that farmers in Punjab do, and that there's no way to stop them? Did you know that there wasn't one gas tragedy in Bhopal, but three? One of them was seen, but two were unseen. Did you know that many well-intentioned government policies hurt the people they're supposed to help? Why was demonetization a bad idea? How should GST have been implemented? Why are all our politicians so corrupt when not all of them are bad people? I'm Amit Verma, and in my weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen, I take a shot at answering all these questions and many more. I aim to go beyond the scene and show you the unseen effects of public policy and private action. I speak to experts on economics, political philosophy, cognitive neuroscience, and constitutional law so that their insights can blow not only my mind, but also yours. The Seen and the Unseen releases every Monday. So do check out the archives and follow the show at seenunseen.in. You can also subscribe to The Seen and the Unseen on whatever podcast app you happen to prefer.
Hi, welcome back to States of Anarchy. I'm with Deepal and we're talking about India's self-image and how it's dealt with Bhutan and Sikkim. So what happens after Nehru meets with the Bhutanese king in 58, you'd said, right? So how do relations progress the decade after?
So, I mean, multiple things happen, right? In the early... So if you look at the selected works of Jawaharlal Nehru, in 58, you find a number of these, you know, reports. He actually sits down there and he's writing these reports about his impression of Bhutan and everything. He's writing to the foreign secretary, who is Swimal Dutt at that point in time, and he's saying that, you know, I think they need help in, or they can be helped in these aspects or these sectors. He talks about education, infrastructure, to name a few, and how do we do that and things like that. In early 1960s, we see the first five-year plan for Bhutan that comes about, which is entirely funded by India at that point. And that is when the first set of motorable roads in Bhutan actually get made.
Okay. Right?
Subsequently, throughout the 60s, we see these advisors. There was this gentleman called Nari Rustamji.
Okay.
Who is sent as an advisor to the Bhutanese king. In fact, he had a role to play in the airport, the Paro airport, which I mean is the prime airport to get in Bhutan. In Paro.
Sorry,
it's an hour away from Thimphu, and the old kingdom and the old capital. So that is still the major, the only international airport, I think, in Bhutan. So he designs that, and there are these documents which show that, you know, he's they're talking about building these schools, okay, and trying to get teachers from across the world, in fact, from Europe, right? So all of these things start happening in the 1960s. The Border Roads Organization gets developed around the same time. The IMTRAT, which is the Indian Army's training team for Bhutanese Army officials, all of that happens in the 1960s, right? There are a number of these visits that happen from Delhi into Bhutan. Now here is this also this thing where, you know, while we talked about the treaty, right, and how the treaties were different for Sikkim and Bhutan, right? Now, however, in Delhi's mind, there was Sikkim and Bhutan were always hyphenated, right?
And what sort of evidence did you find for that?
So, for one, every time you see that whenever a minister or an official or the foreign secretary or whoever makes a visit to one of the two, they make a visit to the other, right? To the point where this gentleman called B.S. Das, who I spoke with in 2016, who unfortunately passed on some months later, B.S. Das was India's first ambassador to Bhutan in 1968. Okay. He also had a role to play in Sikkim a few years after, so someone who had been in the thick of things, you know. So he talked about how the Bhutanese king at some point told him that, you know, what I don't like is, why do your people always have this thing of going to Sikkim and Bhutan at the same time? Why can't they make just one visit to Bhutan, okay, or to Sikkim? Leave. I mean, you seem to want to say that we are similar, but I am emphatically telling you that we are not. So as you can see, Bhutan was very aware of its difference in status, as an international entity, from Sikkim at that point in time. And they were very keen that that message be conveyed, you know, to India, right? So that is something that's very, very significant.
And this is sort of reflected in their bid for UN membership as well.
Yes, which is something that they had been talking about right from the 1950s. Near the ending of 1950s, in fact, a Bhutanese group had even come to... There were always these people from Bhutan who used to come to India, right? Sure. Elites and all of them. And they had even brought up this in Delhi, right? Mm-hmm. In 1959, I think, 58 or 59. They had brought this up where it's talked about... how if Bhutan became a member of the United Nations, they would be as a full-fledged international member of the international community, they would be even more effective in acting as a barrier against China. Right. So you see what they're doing. They're very carefully positioning them in a way that they think will be acceptable to India or attractive to India. Right.
Yeah.
So that's also something that happens around the same time. Now, there is also another reason why fundamentally India, Delhi, looked at Sikkim and Bhutan through more or less the same lens.
All right.
Till about 1968, right, the political office in Sikkim, okay, was the apex body which reported to Delhi about the region. Okay. Right. And so the political office in Sikkim was based out of Gangtok. Right. So and what were they responsible for? They had been, and this is something that had been going on from the days of the Raj. Right?
Okay.
So they had been responsible for the relationship with Sikkim.
Hmm.
They were also responsible for the relationship with Bhutan.
Hmm.
And in earlier years, okay, before Tibet was, before in the pre 1962 years, they were also responsible for the relationship with Tibet.
Hmm.
Right. So immediately, if one person, the political officer, is someone who is conversing with the Sikkimese royal family and with the Bhutanese king and also Lhasa, which we are not getting into now, if it's the same person who is talking to both of them and is reporting to Delhi, and Delhi is, you know, communicating with him for this, it is kind of, it's even a matter of, you know, bureaucratic... just to make things easier, essentially, right? It's the same person you're dealing with. So whenever you deal with them, you possibly hyphenate the two places. But what it also does for the entire bureaucracy is it brings those two places together, something that Bhutan was not at all okay with.
Yeah, I guess you sort of get it like an institutional lens that looks at Bhutan and Sikkim just by virtue of it having the mandate over these three places, right? So I think that's sort of like an obvious outcome of, I guess, just like bureaucratic... work?
I suppose so. Yeah, I think yes, because when these people are looking at Sikkim and Bhutan or looking at the political office in Sikkim, which deals with both Sikkim and Bhutan, they are not really thinking about, you know, the 1949 treaty said this, but the 1950 treaty said that, right? So they're different. Okay, we should think of them or treat them differently. They are just doing, it's just easier, right? So that is basically one of the things that happened. But while it was easy for Delhi to deal that way, Bhutan was definitely not happy to be bracketed with Sikkim in all aspects.
Yeah, it's like the front bencher in the class asking not to be equated with the last person.
Yeah. I think that's possibly one way of looking at it. In fact, one of the things that it led to in 1968 was the creation of an office of the representative of India in Bhutan. And what that did also was, you know, all of these people, they used to send these weekly and monthly reports to Delhi, right? Mm. Okay, this month, this is what has happened in Sikkim, and this is what has happened in Bhutan and things like that. Till 1968, the report that was sent from the political office in Sikkim was one consolidated report about Sikkim and Bhutan.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah,
and this month in Sikkim and Bhutan, right? And... after 1968, we see that physical separation happening.
Hmm.
There's a separate gentleman who's sitting in Thimphu, somewhere in Bhutan or whatever, and he is giving his own separate report on Bhutan.
Hmm.
I think in the initial months, that was first being sent to the political office in Sikkim, and then from there sent to Delhi and all of that.
Yeah.
But there's a separate person, right? So that also happens in the late 1960s.
All right. And when does India finally nominate Bhutan?
Right. So the nomination of Bhutan for the United Nations is something that the Bhutanese parliament, Bhutan had a parliament which advised the king.
Hmm.
Right. Now, the Bhutanese parliament has been asking about it and talking about it throughout the 1960s at various points in time. And again, this is something that India appreciated, right? Mm. The king, he assures the parliament that I'm going to take care of it.
Mm.
Okay, I'm going to speak to India about this. But at the same time, he is cognizant of India's, he doesn't embarrass India by talking about this at an inopportune moment, right? Mm. You know, so when we talked about how the relationship between Sikkim and Bhutan separates and becomes different, this is also an important aspect, because in case of Sikkim, we see that Delhi's impression is that the Chogyal will lose no opportunity to embarrass us.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
With Bhutan, they're absolutely certain that, you know, the Bhutanese king will not do anything to embarrass us. Mm. Right. So anyway, so they keep talking at various points in time. Now in 1970, what happens is the Bhutanese king, Jigme Dorji Wangchuk, he's unwell by this point in time. Okay. And he knows that he's going to be ill. He's not going to be around for very long. So he decides to do a couple of things to make sure that his son, the eventual fourth king, Jigme Singye Wangchuk, has a smooth succession.
Mm.
So what are these things that he does? One, he begins talking to India about the United Nations membership sponsorship, right?
All right.
Because if Bhutan becomes a full-fledged member of the international community with a presence in the United Nations, that makes it secure in many ways, including from, let's say, undue influence from India or from any other player.
Yeah, it's right. Just sort of like assuring yourself of your own sovereignty, right? And like international recognition of that is a huge
absolutely. It's an insurance policy.
Yeah.
Right, essentially. So that's one thing he does. The other thing he does is that he has this half-brother who has a number of followers among the younger Bhutanese elites.
Okay.
Who at that point are talking about how, you know, maybe India is not doing enough for Bhutan and maybe Bhutan should look at others and everything else. Now, so that India doesn't become too concerned about that, and also so that this person does not become a problem in succession plans and various other things, he makes this person in charge of the of Bhutan's preparations for becoming a member of the UN. Hmm. Right. So gives him an important job. It's fascinating. Right. So in this way, there are these conversations that begin with India about Bhutan's membership of the United Nations. Now, in 1971, the proposal is finally sent.
Hmm.
Right. And by that time, the foreign minister of Bhutan, the half-brother of the king, you know, all of them have been to New York. They have basically lobbied and talked, canvassed for it, essentially. You know, they've talked to various members and told them about Bhutan wanting to be a member of the United Nations. They have used India's offices, right? And India also by this time is completely behind Bhutan on this, right? As I mentioned earlier, diplomats across the world, you know, are the MEA is sending them these advisories if anyone questions Bhutan's relationship and whether Bhutan is completely sovereign and if they can become an individual member, this is how we tackle it, right? So all of that is happening. And sometime in 1971, eventually, Bhutan gets accepted as a member of the United Nations, right? Now, once that happens, Bhutan at that point in time obviously does not have the wherewithal to conduct its business, right? So the second in command at the Indian embassy in Bhutan, this gentleman called A.N. Ram, he's sent as the deputy permanent representative of Bhutan to New York.
Okay.
Right. So he's essentially an Indian national who goes there. And I spoke to him some years ago and he said that, you know, while I was there during the day, I would wear their national dress and I would conduct myself in Bhutanese business and I became Bhutanese for the day. And at night I would come home, I'd change into my other clothes and I would then again become an Indian. So it's a fascinating thing of how close the association is at this point in time.
That's a very interesting story.
It is.
Now, contrast that with what happened in Sikkim for me. We know that the annexation of Sikkim happened in 1975.
Right.
Call it annexation, call it the merger with Sikkim.
Sure.
Your choice of words. Yeah. But I know we don't have possibly the time to go into the nitty-gritties of what happened with the annexation of Sikkim. But can you explain sort of briefly how that worked between the same periods of time, which is through the 60s and the 70s.
Right, sure. Before we get into the annexation of Sikkim, there's another story.
All right.
So the other important, interesting story that comes out of Bhutan around this time is 1971 is also the year when the Bangladesh War happens.
Oh, yes, of course.
Right?
Yeah.
And the Bangladesh War is one where India found itself almost alone in the international stage, save one country, Bhutan.
Yeah.
Right, which came to India's side right in the beginning. And what we also see happening, very interestingly, is the king issues an appeal to the Bhutanese citizens and says that, you know, now this is the point when the refugees are flowing into India from East Pakistan, right? So he starts raising money for these refugees. He comes to Calcutta, near Kolkata, where the refugee camps are. He meets the refugees himself, goes back to Bhutan, says that, you know, we need to raise money for them, puts in a substantial amount of money himself, goes to his various family members, raises money, and encourages his citizens to raise money for these refugees, right? He also speaks with the Indian Prime Minister, Indira Gandhi, at that point in time, and he says that, you know, I have a small army, but if you want it, it's yours, right? Now, whether or not eventually India would have needed his army is besides the point. The point is that all of this also suggests to India that this is someone that you can depend on. Right. This is someone who's solidly next to you. Right.
Yeah. No, this is just fascinating because whether it's this or it's the story of A.N. Ram going to represent Bhutan at the world stage, these are stories about the relations between the two states that I don't think a lot of people have heard about even or aware of.
Yeah. I mean, so unfortunately, I mean, most of the stories of India's foreign relations are you know, formed of, if not of the biggest states or most powerful states, like, let's say, US, UK, China, and all of that, or Pakistan, for example. It is even when we look at the neighborhood, most stories are about, let's say, a Bangladesh or a Nepal or a Sri Lanka, which are bigger players. Bhutan, we keep thinking, is this really small player which is there? But it's a fascinating relationship and it's a fascinating story. And by not looking at these various very interesting episodes, I think we run the risk of taking this relationship for granted.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think it's always important, to first capture narratives and histories that exist. And I agree with you when I say that I think that we sort of do a disservice to just like the people who've come before us in laying foundations. I mean, if you remove that sort of institutional memory of what a policy towards a particular state is, then you're left with very short-sighted goals.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. No, I mean, and exactly. I mean, with Bhutan, for example, right? The relationship hasn't come here on its own, right? There have been countless men and women who have worked for the relationship to be here for years, right? It has been because of the efforts, the sincerity, the minds, you know, of so many people, right? This B.S. Das, for example, right? He writes in one of his books about in 68, when he was going to take over as the representative, he went to Bhutan with the then foreign secretary, T.N. Kaul, right? And he talks about how obviously, there was no heating or anything in Bhutan at that point in time. And it's not very well developed. And he talks about the house that that they were put up in when they first got there had mud walls. Okay, so he talks about it was extremely cold and it was Diwali.
Okay.
Right. So obviously, they're very upset at being away from families. Okay, they're there and they will meet the king. But he, at that point, not too many people knew or understood Bhutan. So he's wondering, what am I doing here, right? And then T.N. Kaul brings out a deck of cards from his briefcase. And they sit there and they play cards to, you know, bring in the flavor of Diwali, right? And it's inconvenient and they're doing all of that, right? But with the idea that all of this will amount to something at some point in time, right? And looking at history, essentially, or looking at these nuanced versions or conversations in history is important, essentially, because otherwise we run the risk of taking these relationships as a given.
Yeah.
Right? So the Bhutanese king, after December, when the war ends, Bhutan becomes the first country to acknowledge, recognize independent Bangladesh.
Before India.
And again, the dispatches from Bhutan at that point in time that come to Delhi, are glowing in their appreciation of the king's behavior, right? Mm. No one seems to. So technically, Bhutan is supposed to be advised in its foreign affairs by India.
Mm.
But at this point in time, no one really seems to care because, you know, in Delhi, there is this exuberance of having proved the world wrong, of having, you know, liberated Bangladesh. And the fact that Bhutan has done this, it's just greatly appreciated. What Bhutan also does is forms a trade relationship with Bangladesh and starts direct flights between Bangladesh, right? So that also kind of establishes Bhutan as its own player.
Mm.
You know, so that's Bhutan's takeaway from that, right? Which just goes on increasing in the subsequent years because obviously Bhutan by that time is a member of the UN and so on and so forth.
All right, now coming to Sikkim.
Yes. So the relationship with Sikkim, unfortunately, as I told you, there was the Chogyal, right, who was very keen on establishing a Sikkimese identity, right, which what was his version of Sikkimese identity was possibly largely a Lepcha Bhutia identity, not the Nepalese identity. But there was that. But there were also these other people, for example, his wife, right, who was this American lady called Hope Cook, who still lives in New York, I believe. Who was the Chogyal's second wife, met him while she was traveling to Darjeeling, got married in after a whirlwind romance and everything else. And then suddenly she got introduced into this entire milieu. And now I have heard, I mean, there were rumors at that point in time that she was...
CIA.
Yes, which... I have not found any historical evidence of, and from all the literature that I have seen, all the archival documents that I have seen, it does not seem that anyone very serious, anyone important, anyone of consequence, who was, you know, eyes of ears of the Indian government, at least in Sikkim, seemed to believe that she was, okay? They reported that, okay, there is, you know, they are talking about how she is CIA, but they don't say that, oh, you know, we think she is CIA. So there is that. You know?
I'm going to confess to you at this point, Deep, that one of the reasons that I really wanted to talk to you about Sikkim was to really find out if Hope Cook was CIA. Because I don't know if that's a narrative to just sort of spread mistrust in the Chogyal and the Sikkimese government at that point in time.
Mm-hmm.
Or if she was actually CIA and you have this very Hollywoodish...
Okay, so... okay, I'll be very non-committal here. I'll say I have seen no evidence that suggests that she was CIA.
Fair enough.
Okay,
all right.
That does not mean she wasn't, but... If you ask me, I don't think she was.
All right.
Okay. But here's the thing. It didn't take for her to be CIA to worsen matters between Sikkim and India.
Mm.
Right. There was so much else that was going on. For one, she basically, once she got in here, and she obviously had to be taken in both by the Chogyal and by a Sikkimese life to want to agree to, you know, sit down and in Sikkim and promise to spend her life here and everything else, right? So she got into the thick of Sikkimese elite life, which also meant, for example, giving birth to or setting up organizations, informal organizations, right, which were considered, which basically officially were opportunities for young Sikkimese elites, people who worked in the government and so on and so forth, to come together and talk about how to improve Sikkim and Sikkimese life, right?
Mm.
But clearly, Indian representatives there believe that that was basically where they hatched plans on how to oppose India or embarrass India and things like that, right? So she was in the bad books of the political offices in Sikkim already because of things like that.
Mm.
Also, around the same time, she wrote this article. So Darjeeling, for example, used to be a part of Sikkim till 1835, I think.
Middle
of the 19th century. Now, in a transaction between the British and the Sikkimese royal family, Darjeeling was turned over to the British, okay, because it was important for tea cultivation, things like that. And there was a promise made of giving Sikkim a certain amount of land, which was not something that was fulfilled. Now, Hope Cook, in the 1960s, writes an article in which she says that, you know, Darjeeling belongs to Sikkim. Right. And that, again, is sets the cat among the pigeons, right? I mean, that is obviously something that Delhi doesn't want to talk about or think about. And remember, Sikkim at this point is a separate state, right? Sikkim is not a state in India.
So when you're talking about India's self-image and you're talking about India's territorial integrity in that sense, and saying that Darjeeling is a part of Sikkim must have just been very infuriating to people at Delhi and in Sikkim, I'm guessing.
No, absolutely. I mean, so this basically means two things. One, it means that India is much like an imperial power, which is obviously not acceptable, right? It also means, because India is holding on to land that is actually someone else's, or it also means that India's boundaries, right, are not India's boundaries, right? You were immediately putting into question one of that, right? So essentially, the Sikkimese map extends further down, right, in the south to engulf what is at that point in the northern part of Bengal, right? So yes, from both aspects, this is not acceptable. So in fact, there are these MEA files that I have seen where, you know, the MEA says, okay, there is this article, you know, is there any merit to this question, right? And then there are responses to it saying that, you know, this was something that was between the British, and now obviously there can be no question of turning this over and everything else, because Darjeeling at that point is a bustling Indian economic center. You know, it's impossible to have this conversation at that point in time. And also, no one really wanted to have that conversation, right? Because I would assume that Hope Cook, by writing that, did not really think that Darjeeling would come back to Sikkim. It was basically to, you know, ruffle the feathers.
She wanted to make a point about
Sikkim. She wanted to make a point. Also, I think she was hoping to appeal to a Sikkimese sense of identity, right? That is what all of them were trying to do.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So that would have been another issue. Now, so there were enough reasons for Hope Cook to, whether she was CIA or not, there was enough reason for her to not be liked by people in Delhi. So this is happening. Now, there were, in 1968, on Indian Independence Day, you know, when the flag hoisting and everything else is going on, there were protests, right, in Gangtok against India. And some of the slogans seem to suggest an affinity to their northern neighbor. Right. So essentially to China. Right. I mean, the wording of the slogan said our northern neighbor.
So they didn't spell it out. But
they didn't spell it out. But that is all it can mean.
Yeah.
Right? Which absolutely changed things. Right. Because that was obviously not something that personally and physically the Chogyal was doing. But the reports from Sikkim at that point said, you know, the people who are organizing this are known to be close to the Chogyal and things like that. And obviously this cannot happen without his knowledge or his influence or, you know, somehow his involvement.
Yeah, I agree. I think if you look at it from a bureaucrat at that point in time's view, you would say, you know, these are protests that are happening in a public sphere. These ideas would not come without strains of these thought going into the Chogyals, amongst the political advisors of the Chogyal as well, if not himself. And so I could see, and particularly considering that this is the aftermath of 1962, and it's not very long after that, I could see why Indian diplomats would be alarmed.
Absolutely. I mean, by this point in time, anything that talks about China. See, another difference between Sikkim and Bhutan is that Sikkim is more accessible, right, to Tibet because largely of Nathula, right? Bhutan also to an extent is, but not as much, right? I mean, Sikkim gives you access to, through Nathula, it gives you access right up to the plains and Chicken's Neck and all of that, which we have talked about 2 years ago during Doklam and everything also, right? Now, so obviously that's an important aspect. So anytime in Sikkim, the moment the conversation turns towards China, okay, everyone in Delhi just stands up and says, okay, this is something that we need to consider right away. So that happens in 68. The Nathula thing has just happened in 67. Hope Cook becomes an important aspect. And during all of this, we see the Chogyal in various ways, which are not very important or do not hurt India really. Okay. But he keeps trying to defy the treaty in various ways, right? So, for example, the treaty says external communication would be taken care of by India. The Chogyal sends congratulatory messages, you know, to various world leaders for either their birthdays or for various incidents, right? And that is something that irritates India, right? So, that's one thing that keeps on happening. On the other hand, they keep trying to, you know, so for example, early 1970s, with the help of Hope Cook's contacts in the US, they have this fashion show that they do in New York,
okay?
Which essentially has models walking around in Sikkimist clothes, right? Mm. That is basically their way of getting awareness raised in the US about Sikkim and Sikkimist clothes and things like that.
Mm.
They keep inviting... So they're not supposed to have foreign experts in Sikkim without explicit permission from India and things like that. They keep having people come into Sikkim as the guest of the palace, but they are actually the experts who work on various things.
Right? Sure.
So there are various kinds of things keep on happening. And the way that India deals with it eventually is by taking help of this guy called Kazi Lendub Dorji, who is a politician who's been around for really long. He's a pro-democracy politician. He leads a party that has largely Nepalese supporters. And at some point, Indira Gandhi meets the chief of RAW at that point in time, Kao, and essentially says that, okay, let's figure out what we can do about Sikkim. And that is how the Research and Analysis Wing actually gets its hands into Sikkim. Remember, Kao at this point is just coming out of Bangladesh, right?
Which has been
a super success and everything else, right? So this is his new project, next project that he gets into. As a result of this, in 1973, there come about these kind of political agitations, which the Chogyal fails to control. Right. Now, part of the treaty and some letters exchanged after that said that if the Chogyal requests India to handle law and order situations, India would have to do it. Now, the Chogyal at that point does not really want to do it because he realizes once that happens, he's going to lose all power to India, right?
Yeah,
India is going to come in and not leave.
Exactly.
Right? He does not want to do that, but eventually he gives in as things become worse and worse. And once that happens, effectively, that is the beginning of the end of Chogyal's hold over Sikkim and executive powers in Sikkim. B.S. Das, who was in Bhutan earlier, is brought in as something called a chief executive, who takes up almost all of the Chogyal's executive responsibilities. In subsequent elections, Kazi Lendub Dorji and his party, they continue to win. They ask India, and this is happening between 73 and 74, right? And 70, going towards 75. I mean, I'm not going into all the nitty-gritties, but essentially, it's like a domino effect by this point. So Kazi and his people, they ask India if, you know, it is possible to have Sikkimese representation in the Indian parliament. Okay, they ask help for a new constitution, which in a couple of weeks, okay, a new, this gentleman who is set up as an advisor, he comes up with a new constitution, right? So all of these things keep moving. Now, by 74, India is more or less in control of Sikkim's executive apparatus. Right. And the assumption, and the Chogyal even at that point is the titular head. Right. And the Indian Foreign Secretary by that point, Kewal Singh, he has promised the Chogyal that, you know, you will continue to be the Chogyal of Sikkim and it will pass on to your son. It seems that India's expectations were that the Chogyal is going to eventually
step down.
He's going to get quieter and he's just going to settle into this titular responsibility. Okay. But the Chogyal doesn't do that. Right. In early 1975, he goes to Nepal to attend the coronation of then King Birendra. Right. And during that, he meets Chinese representatives who were also there.
Okay.
And he talks to various people, complaining to them about India, and holds a press conference. And that really leads to the point where soon after he is deposed. Right. There is this book called Smash and Grab.
Okay.
Which is by Sunanda K. Datta-Ray, who a journalist who was there in Sikkim at that point in time. It was unofficially unavailable in India for a really long time.
Okay.
It's recently been reprinted and it's available. That has a really close account of what happens. He's deposed in 1975. Okay. There's a referendum that happens, right? And in that referendum, essentially over 90% of the population of Sikkim says that they want to be a part of India.
Okay.
So by the middle of 1975, Sikkim becomes a part of India.
All right.
Now, the only questionable thing about this is the amazing alacrity with which all of this happens, the speed at which the referendum is organized and everything else. And but that's, again, another story.
Another story for another day. But This is really interesting when you compare what happens at Bhutan and Sikkim. And we spoke about how both the countries are very alike and about mm-hmm. how India also saw them as hyphenated entities, but had very different policy responses towards the both of them. So where do you think that comes from?
Right. I think more than them being alike, institutionally, the responses to them were very alike for a really long period of time, right? One fundamental difference, as I said, was in the understanding of security, right? Because Sikkim was far more closely accessible from Tibet in comparison to Bhutan, right? So that's one. But I think the major policy difference comes about is when India looked at these two with its ideas of self-image and saw how they reacted, right? Bhutan talks about a great deal of closeness with India throughout, right? We see Jigme Dorje Wangchuk do that, and the two kings that have come after that continue to do that. Sikkim continued to talk about, like I told you, in the protesters talked about, you know, affinity to their northern neighbors, right? Or after the Nathula incident happens in 1968, the skirmish between the Indian and Chinese soldiers happens, you know, the Chogyal seems to say, you know, it's difficult to say who started it. It could be the Indians or the Chinese, right? So there is this constant issue of insecurity, which I think led to a point where in Delhi, the question that they were trying to answer is, if we need the Chogyal to stand by us in a moment of crisis tomorrow, will he do that? And I think their sense was that he won't. Right, which is what, so, I mean, in 1974, the assumption was that the Chogyal would get comfortable in his role as a titular head, which did not happen, which is why in 1975, that is what the available documents and the people I've spoken to seem to suggest, that maybe it wouldn't have happened had he not gone to Nepal and talked about, you know, talked to the Chinese representatives or talked about Indian excesses as he saw them in Sikkim.
Sure, but like that would be a counterfactual analysis into going to what he could and could not have done. So clearly there were differences. If you look at your three criteria which of self-image, which I think you said was civilization, territory and
development.
Right. So in development, how did
so for
change?
Example, in Bhutan, as I mentioned, all the various developmental aspects that were there, and Bhutan at all times seemed to appreciate that. And in fact, even after 1971, for example, right? So one of the major things that happened after Bhutan became a member of the UN is various countries wanted to open their embassies in Bhutan, right? And they wanted to collaborate with Bhutan, bring in aid and things like that. And Bhutan said two things. One, they said that at this point, they only have resources to have two embassies, one in Delhi and one in New York. Okay, and that's it. They won't be able to have more embassies. And two, and so, which basically means that opening of embassies is reciprocal, right? If a country comes and opens an embassy, you have to go and open an embassy there.
Yeah.
So by not opening embassies elsewhere, you're stopping people from coming and opening embassies in your country. So that's one. And the second thing they did was when, you know, various countries came and said, okay, can we have a development relationship and things like that? Bhutan thanked them and said that, you know, right now we're at capacity. I'm sure we will do it in future, but right now we're not in a position to take aid from you, right? So, for example, there's the British High Commissioner in Delhi spoke to the Bhutanese representative in Delhi about this. This is the response he got. A British Overseas Development Assistance team actually traveled to Bhutan in 1974, I think, or just before that. Okay, and they asked about various things about, you know, the Bhutanese representatives that they met talked about the various ways in aspects in which they need help in terms of agriculture, technology and this and that. Okay. But they were not jumping in to say, okay, bring in all the aid and technology that you can. So, and at all of these times, they still seemed very careful about how India looked at the issue, right? By this point, Indian representatives in their internal notes to each other about Bhutan are saying that, you know, we'll have to let this go, okay? Now Bhutan can reach out to the world, right? So they are accepting it, right? They are aware of this. They're completely cognizant of this. But Bhutan still seems to do this very carefully and in a calibrated way, right?
Yeah, yeah.
When it comes to Sikkim, for example, in 1968, Indira Gandhi travels to Sikkim, right? And so the Chogyal and Indira Gandhi, they have this meeting in a stadium which has been built with Indian money.
Okay.
And, you know, that is possibly the high point of Sikkim's relationship with India or India's relationship with Sikkim, right? Where they talk about how, you know, with this, so the Chogyal thanks India for the aid and for everything that India has done, and India is happy to know that. But from there, it's downhill. Okay, the Chogyal refuses to acknowledge Indian aid. India is not happy with the Chogyal, and things just don't go well from there.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Okay, this is something that I've been wondering through our conversation over the last 1.5 hours. But how did you go about researching all of this? Because you have stories that I don't think I've heard ever before. So how did you get access to all of this?
So, okay, so one part is I spoke with people who were there at various points in time. V.S. Das is someone I told you about.
Yeah.
There are also various other bureaucrats who have been who have worked in Sikkim and Bhutan, or even in Delhi, dealing with the Emir's Northern Division, which deals with these parts. So I've spoken with a lot of these people. But most interestingly, what has been happening in the last few years is the opening up of a lot of basically the declassification and becoming available of a lot of documents. So in Delhi, there are two places that one can go to, right? One is the National Archives of India, and the other is the Teen Murti Bhavan, the Nehru Memorial Library, right? Museum and Library. Now, what Nehru Memorial has essentially are private papers, right? So people who were important in these phases, how were they thinking?
Okay.
Right? And their connections with various people, right? Now, and in NAI, when you look at the Emir documents, what you find is how policy was being applied on ground. So it's the view is from two different levels, right? There are Teen Murti Bhavan, it's basically the elites who are talking to each other. Is this how we should go about it? Is this right? Is this wrong? Is this feasible? Is this viable, right? And the applications of those thoughts are in the documents that you find at NAI. Now, it takes a lot of patience. It's not a perfect system, but I mean, I think there are more archival documents, and not just about Sikkim, Bhutan, about Indian foreign policy as a whole. Okay. I think there are more archival documents, more archival material that is available now than has been ever before. So if anyone, any of the listeners want to get into archival research, now is the time to do it. Also, it's a great great lesson in patience, which I think all of us could do more with.
All right. I think that's also telling about what we should look forward to in archival research.
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay, so this is my last question for you, Deep, since you've spent hours and hours at the archives in India, and you've spent a lot of time reading. What would be books or resources that you recommend for someone who wants to know more about the history of Bhutan, about the history of Sikkim, about India's relationships with these countries?
Right, so I would have ideally wanted to suggest my book, but since I haven't written that yet, in the meantime, so on Sikkim, there are a couple of books. I mentioned Smash and Grab.
Yes, Sunanda Kedata.
Sunanda Kedatra, Smash and Grab, Annexation of Sikkim, right? It's basically written from the ground. So there is that. There's also a more recent book, which also takes a view of the palace, which is called Requiem for a Himalayan Kingdom, which is by this journalist called Andrew Duff.
Okay.
Right? So these are two books that look at the developments from the perspective of the palace. Now, the involvement of the Raw is something that was always hinted about, but no one really talked about it. There is a very recent book that's come out, which is very candid about it. It's by this gentleman called G.B.S. Siddhu, who was a Raw officer on ground.
All right.
And it's called Sikkim, Dawn of Democracy.
Okay.
So if one wants to get a better idea of Sikkim, reading these two sides should help. Now, unfortunately about Bhutan, there are a lot of books by many of the Indian officers who were stationed there, but almost all of them are out of print.
Okay.
Unfortunately,
that's
right? That's something that as a state, as a nation, as a society, we should possibly think about more, you know, making history more easily accessible. But more recently, there is this book by Rajesh, Foreign Policy of Bhutan.
Okay.
Right. And another one by Omair, which is called The Kingdom at the Center of the World.
Okay.
Right. So these should be good starting points on these two places.
All right. Okay. Thank you so much, Deep. Hopefully at some point we will add your book to the list of resources that people can read.
I certainly hope so. Thank you so much, Hansini. It's been great being here.
Thank you.
That's it for this episode of States of Anarchy. Thanks for staying with us. If you want to read more about Bhutan and Sikkim, I've attached a bunch of recommended readings for you in the episode description, so you can scroll down and check them out. You can also follow States of Anarchy on Twitter @HamsiniH and on Instagram @StatesofAnarchy. If you want to delve deeper into some of the topics that we discussed on the podcast, whether it's public policy or foreign policy, I suggest you check out some of the courses at the Takshashila Institution. They are of varying lengths, so you can choose depending on your interest. So check those out as well. If you like what you listen to, then do subscribe to States of Anarchy. We're not only on the IVM podcast app and website, but also on iTunes, Spotify, Savan, Castbox, or wherever you get your podcasts. We'll be back next Tuesday.
This is the amazing story of something awesome. Once Chuck decided to start a podcast, and so he did. The end. Okay, that was a crappy story. But I've got some really cool stories over at my new show, The Origin of Things. On this podcast, I look at the stories of how brands came into being and sometimes evolved out of quite unexpected circumstances. And to make it really fun, I reveal the name of the brand and sometimes a category only at the very end. The show is 5 to 7 minutes per episode and perfect for trivia junkies and brand nerds, especially those with short attention spans. New episodes out every Wednesday on IVM Podcast app or website, or any podcast app or site that you happen to prefer. End of story, they lived happily ever after.
Hi guys, this is Ayushi.
And I am Ritasha.
And welcome to Agla Station Adulthood.
It's a fun podcast we've got going on, and we'd love for you to tune in and enjoy with us.
Join us as we stop at various stations and discuss different topics that seem to be bothering us and hopefully
dating,
you as
relationships,
well.
Relationships, beauty, just being an adult, lots of different things.
We don't have a great grip on it, but we've done okay so far.
Catch Agla Station Adulthood every Thursday on the IVM app, the IVM website, or wherever else you get your podcasts.